Good morning, it's Saturday the 20th of June 2015. Yes, gang, it's another United Kingdom talk. And look at outside, it looks like it's... They said they were going to rain today, and I've rushed out this morning. Morning, Mark. Mark's with us already. I've rushed out and bought all the washing in that I've been... It's been out there overnight, actually, the whole night. Do you ever do that? Just leave the washing out all night, because it wasn't quite dry. And then last night on the way, well, when I got in, I had a quick look at the weather before I got into bed, and it did say it was going to rain this morning. Nothing yet. Nothing yet. The clouds are over. You know, it's not sticky at all. It's a little bit chillier than it has been recently. But no rain yet. And I looked out, just literally a few seconds ago, I looked out the window and I've left one of my chairs out there. I mean, they're garden chairs, so it doesn't really matter. You know, if they get wet, they soon dry out. I get a little bit wet, like my personality, dear. You know, it... I might get my undies nicked at night, Simon says. No, I don't wear undies, Simon. I really don't wear undies. Now, just to let you know, so the chair is out there at the moment, and if it gets wet, it gets wet. I shall get a wet bum if I sit on it to have my lunch later on, won't I? Yes, good morning, gang. Just to let you know, if you're watching on YouTube, you can also watch this show on Periscope, OK? Download the app from the iTunes store. Or the Android store, it's called Periscope. And once you've downloaded that, look for username, search for username chrisreardonuk. That's me, add me there, and you can watch it on your mobile devices wherever you are. Similarly, if you're watching on Periscope, then you might want to watch on YouTube. Switch on your computer, go to youtube.com/chrisreardonuk. youtube.com/chrisreardonuk. Now, you'll hear me read out various messages throughout the show. Some of those messages come from Periscope, some come from Skype, some come from emails. OK, you can join in several ways at any point of the show today, gang. By Skype. My Skype username is United Kingdom Talk. If you've got Skype, add that and you'll feel free to either send a message or indeed call in as well. Okay? Skype username, Chris Reardon. No, what was it? Skype username is United Kingdom Talk. Once again, the Skype username is United Kingdom Talk. There is a local London phone number. The phone number is 020-8144-3477. And finally, there's an email address, chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. Simon says I sound very Radio 4 today. You mean my voice has returned in power, but is still about a semitone lower, I think. So I'm like that. Ross says, can I ring in reverse the charges? No, we don't accept reverse charge calls, I'm afraid. Dear me, where would we be if I started accepting reverse charge calls? We can't afford to run like that, dear. Are you having a laugh? Reverse charge calls. Now, a very important day today, gang. We just got to do a happy birthday to someone. Someone regular to the show, boys and girls. They are more regular than you. Absolutely. Millie in Minnesota, it is her birthday today. And I think Millie tonight is 713 years old. So... Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Millie. Happy birthday to you. Oh, and all these people are saying happy birthday. Ross, Rusty wishes you happy birthday, Millie, and indeed all of us here at United Kingdom Talk. Right, happy birthday. Do I sound Radio 4 today? Is that a good thing? Mark says happy birthday as well. Do I sound Radio 4 this morning? This is Red. And now the shipping forecast. I like listening to the shipping bars. Simon says happy birthday. Dino says happy birthday. Look at that. LBC. Do I sound LBC this morning? I don't. Do I really? There's a couple of emails here that came in during the week I wanted to read out to you. First of all, I am shocked and horrified. Shocked and horrified. I don't sound like him. I hope not. Shocked and horrified to hear from Ian Duff. in Canada, who says, I was watching your Periscope this morning. That would have been the 19th. Was that yesterday? The 9th. And blimey, why has June gone so quick? I can't believe it's the 20th of June. Cool. That's gone really quick, June. I was watching you this morning, Chris. And all of a sudden, a flash came onto my screen that there was a liver transplant operation in place in Vancouver, Canada. it was very interesting. I had to make a very hard decision to leave you and go and see the liver transplant. Excuse me for breaking away from your show, from Ian. Well, I'm... halfway to Christmas we are. I'm a little disappointed, Ian, but as long as you catch up on the replay later on, Periscope viewers all know about replay. If you miss the show while it's on, you've got 24 hours to catch it up on the replay, after which time it disappears from Periscope. But worry not, gang. You still don't need to miss it, because if you are one of my Facebook or very poor form from Ian, I think, Ross. Yeah, very. Thank you, Ross. Very, very poor form from Ian on yesterday's show. We're a little disappointed. But if you miss it on the replay as well, you can catch it up on either my Facebook or Twitter. I've got both of those. Username is the same on both, OK? Facebook.com/ChrisReardonUK, Twitter.com/ChrisReardonUK. The link to the show that has already been on goes up there, and just have a little look on there, all right? Thank you, Ian. We'll let you... Thank you, Ross. Ross has got my back. All right, thank you very much. Much appreciated. Marj was saying last week, and I wasn't quite sure, she was going on about something about her internet, because she was dropping in and out last week. Marj is in Oklahoma in the USA, one of our regular people that we like to chat to. Joey, you're on and off today as well, aren't you? Do try and stay with us. Marj says, I was trying to say in the Periscope that my internet server sold out the company to another server, which is Rise Broadband. And they put me on a plan that was supposed to be better, up to 5 gig. And however, where I am, there is no equipment to give me that speed. Plus now, it's cutting me off all the time. They rang out some prices, which I have no idea what was going on, and deducted a few, and my bill was $60 this month. What, instead of what? What were you paying before? Why did you change? Oh, because they sold out, I see. They ran up some prices, which I have no idea what was going on, and deducted a few, and my bill was $60 this month. And I haven't had decent internet yet. I'm not paying it. I don't blame you. I will pay for the basic 47, which they said it was going to be, the 5 gig plan, until they update the equipment, which they said would take 3 months. Oh, my God. As long as that. You see, we don't realise how lucky... I don't realise sometimes how lucky I have. I've got 150 meg download and 10 meg up here. I mean, it's just fantastic. Morning, Adam. It says, hopefully I'll have a better internet service when they do it. I bought my RCA tablet so I could watch Periscope videos, because my brother didn't like me using my phone and it said it would burn up the battery sooner. It's a $50 tablet. That's not bad, is it? Works pretty good, but hard to type on the tiny keyboard, so got to get glasses. That's like me here, you see. I've got to have the glasses to be able to read what's going in front of me now. You know, I think just 6 months back, I didn't need glasses to be able to read the messages. It's since the messages come on the Periscope. That's what I have trouble reading now. Sorry, that's why I was having problems typing. I get many migraines of late and having issues with my head, so I don't make sense. You know why? Had to remember to turn it off at night. The Twitter bird wakes me at 4 a.m. The Twitter bird. You can turn... Anyone want to call in and do an impression of a Twitter? Tweet, 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 tweet. We love the Twitter bird. Oh, you can't not like the Twitter bird, surely. I mean, it tweets, but when I look, I still haven't got a clue what's going on Twitter. What's all those arts suddenly appeared for? What have I done? Was that for the tweeting? Do you want it again? Tweet, 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 tweet. Can I just explain, those of you watching on YouTube, on the Periscope, where the show's carried as well now, if you like something, you can send hearts, and they appear on the screen, and there's a load gone up there. It must have been the Twittering. I'm going, tweet, 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 tweet. I used to have a budgie. We had two budgies when I was a little boy, when we lived in Roehampton. There was a yellow one, looked like a canary actually, but it was a budgie, bright yellow budgie, very unusual. And it was called George. George the budgie, bright yellow. That died. No, it didn't die. No, it did. I lied. We used to let it out of the cage, right? And it would fly around the room quite happily, and it would perch itself up on the curtain rail thing, land various places, and it would quite happily sit on your finger and you could talk to it and all that. And then we left the door open, the balcony door, a few times, and it accidentally the first time, and we noticed it didn't fly out. So I thought, oh, well, we won't bother closing it in future. Big mistake. Off it went. It left. Just like most people do while I'm doing my shows. They just suddenly disappear for no reason at all. Why is that? And then we had another budgie called Benny. Benny the budgie. He was blue and grey with black dots and a little bit of white in there as well. You okay, Wendy? You're on and off today. Are you having trouble with your internet, darling? Are you having trouble? We let him out of the cage, flew round and round, and he'd sit on my finger and that. And then one day, I'll never forget, I was playing the piano, because there was a piano in our living room. So we were in a maisonette upstairs. We lived upstairs, like a large three-bedroom flat, right? Council, it was Wandsworth. And we lived in Roehampton. Roehampton is in Wandsworth, okay? And so we got windows at the front and a balcony. And then on one side of the wall was my piano, and on the other side of the wall was a wardrobe type thing. And the budgie's cage was on there. Now I would never entertain having anything in a cage. When you're little, I don't think you realise, you know, I hate animals in cages, the lions or whatever. I really hate animals in cages. Oh, we've dropped out there. Let's just try again. There we are. Let's just... there we are. Is that all right? There we are. Sorry. Just a second. There we are. I think we dropped out then. I'm not quite sure what happened then, gang. Did we just drop out? That's very unusual. It's the first time it's done that. Must have been an update or something like that going on. Anyway, we carry on. The budgie story. Yes. I wouldn't entertain a budgie or indeed anything in a cage. I think it's really cruel. Even SeaWorld, where I've been to SeaWorld, and you see, yes, it's a very, very big tank and all that business, but it's still in a prison, isn't it? It's still in a prison. It really is. Budgie smugglers, someone say. Not quite budgie smugglers, more than Kelly Kim. Anyway, so this budgie, and I was playing the piano once, and when I finished playing the piano, I heard it was making a funny noise, like strange breathing noises. Anyway, so I put my finger... Oh, this is ever so sad, dear. I put my finger in the cage. Budgie came on it as usual, and I said, are you all right? And it was making funny noises like that. And I says, oh, you're going to die, aren't you? And it kept talking anyway. I put it back in the cage. I went down the shops, come back, flat on its back, dead. You know. So be warned. If you ever come round here and you've got a bit of a cold and I start talking to you, you could end up dead on your back. Poor little budgie. There. How did we get onto the subject of the budgies? I don't know. I can't remember now. Never mind, how do we get onto the subject of budgies? Anyone know? Can you remind me? Because I forgot where we were. It was going like that. Budgies. Oh, Twitter, wasn't it? Because we like the Twitter noise. Tweet, 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 tweet. Yeah. I don't know. I rarely use... I keep saying I'm going to use Twitter more. And it just never happens. I mean, let me have a quick look now. Is there anything on there now? No, no one sent me anything. No one sent me anything. It's the story of my life, darling. One more email here. Oh. I've just put a... Okay. It looks like I've just linked to the show and forgotten to put the link on. One second. Oh, sorry, I saw that. Thank you, Wendy, for mentioning that, darling. Let's just do that now. Oh, I see what's happened there. Do that. With you in a second. Talk amongst yourselves for a minute, would you, darlings? Oh, it's all going a little bit wrong today. My computer seems to be very, very slow. Let's refresh that. That's it. I thought what's her name would have been with us today for the birthday song, but she's not there, is she? Oh dear. Right, let's do a live now. Thank you, Wendy, for letting me know that. Live now. It's all going a little bit Pete Tong. It's all right once we get into it. Thank you, Wendy. The link's up there now, my darling. One more email here from Ray Reynolds. Ray Reynolds, again, is a very good friend of mine. I only met up with him about 7 months ago. We've known of each other for a long, long time and only met once for about 10 minutes. Anyway, he's been coming along to the karaoke nights. And Ray used to do what I do. He is a personality type, DJ type. What is it you're doing with all these hearts on there? I don't know what you're up to there, you naughty people. Ray says, hi, Chris. Now, he calls the Periscope shows stethoscope. You know what stethoscope is? That's the thing the doctor puts in his ears and listens to your heart and your breathing. I could do horror. I could do horror. Special effects, couldn't I? Horror special effects. And Ray writes, hi, Chris, just watch your stethoscope show and agree with you so much about the X Factor show and Britain's Got Talent, because we were talking about this last week, weren't we? I neither watch either and hate the fact it goes on and on for so many weeks. Oh, it does, doesn't it? I'm sure it never used to be on as much as it is now. It just goes on and on for weeks and weeks and weeks. And we were saying, you know, the show is basically a modern version. They're trying to create a modern version of a freak show, aren't they? That's what they're trying to do. Or indeed, that's what they've done. And Ray knows I like garden centres. In fact, yesterday, once again, Ron and I went to a garden centre. Now, he knew exactly what he wanted. And we set ourselves a limit. Well, we often set ourselves a limit. Good morning, Ashley. Welcome along to the fun, all right? We set ourselves a limit to how much we were going to spend last night, yesterday during the data. And we succeeded by far. He wanted some poppies that he'd seen in the front, right? So we got to this garden centre and at the front, well, look, the poppies are gone. And we knew that would happen. That's the thing, you know, often I do that. I see something that I like and I might come back. And then you go back the next and it's gone. Oh, well, the same thing's happened to the poppies, isn't it? Oh, I hate it. I hate it. So we've gone into the garden. So let's see if we can find something else. And I wanted a couple of shrubs. I tend to buy shrubs more than, you know, the bedding plants, because shrubs come back year in, year out. So at this very moment, since September, I've been spending not actually all the time. It's certainly in the last 4 or 5 weeks, I've spent quite a lot in the garden. But they're all shrubs, so you only buy them once. So come next year, I shouldn't spend anything like what I've spent, because everything is now there. And it will go to sleep and come back and go to sleep and come back and go to sleep and come back. You know how it works. So we're walking around this garden centre and we saw one of the helpers. Well, actually, she said, oh, hello again, because we'd only been in there 2 days. And she remembered us. How lovely is that? Isn't that lovely? Talking about people remembering you, coming up a little video that you may not have seen. Now, this will only be on the YouTube. I can't do it on the Periscope, unfortunately. So you'll hear it, but you won't be able to see it. It's a video that someone made and sent in, and it's just fantastic. I'll show it to you later on. And she came up to us and said, "Hello, how are you?" And my mate says, "Mate Ron says, have you got those poppies? Where are the poppies gone?" She said, "I'm afraid there's not. They've all gone except I've put a couple over there in the reduced basket." I said, "Oh right, are they all finished now?" She says, "They're not finished." She says, "They will come back again if you put them in the ground, but at the moment they're not looking their best, so they reduce them because no one buys them." And Ron is actually very good like that. He will buy plants that you look at them and you're thinking, "Oh, well, they've had it, you know, dead." Dead as a... No, he puts them in, cares for them, keeps... And they come back to life. I mean, I'm hoping the same thing will happen to you, boys and girls. You know, at that last... When you're close to that last breath, then I will simply plant you into the ground and water you, and you will come back a new person. How fabulous is that? A new person. I will resurrect you from the dead. I'm open to... Where's my cross gone? Oh, there it is. I'm open to pray to that man who sits on there so that I am resurrected one day so I can come back and chat for even longer than I do now. That's exciting, isn't it? Dear, we've dropped out again. Oh, dear me. Now, why is this... There we go. We're back again. I don't know what's going on with the... I don't know what's going on with the Periscope today. That keeps dropping out completely on its own. I've no idea what's going on there. So sorry about that. I'll stick with it. Don't worry. I'll stick with it. Now, where was I? That's completely thrown me. That is. I can't remember where I am now. Have I paid my bill? Yes, I have paid my bill. Of course I've paid my bill. Dear me. What was I just saying? Oh, garden centre. Yep, so he went round to the cheap section and there were the £8 pots of poppies for £1. £1. So he bought four of those, £4. Okay, £4. And then I was walking around looking for shrubs and then he said, "Chris, there's apple trees there for a fiver." They had about seven or eight apple trees sitting there for £5. How fabulous is that? So I said, but the thing is, I'd remembered, yeah, I know, I remembered reading on the internet earlier in the week, because I wanted to buy a couple of apple trees. You're not really supposed to plant them. Well, you can, but this time of the year is probably the worst time you can plant them. They'll get on eventually, but the best time to plant them is November. So I have no intention of buying these. But for £5, and they're in a pot, so at the moment I bought two of those. They're downstairs in the garden. Normal price, £45 each. So I got two apple trees, value £90, for a tenner. That's great, isn't it? £10 for two apple trees. So they're downstairs in their pots in the garden at the moment, waiting for me to finish the show, and then I shall go down and plant them. And there will be free apples for everyone that comes round, boys and girls. Are you coming round for free apples? Who's got apple trees in their garden? Anyone? Let me know if you have. Have you turned Wi-Fi on your mobile? What do you mean? Have I turned... I tell you what I have done. I've switched to airplane mode. No, I've switched to airplane mode to stop people calling in. Morning, Mike. Morning, Mike. Now, what are you going on about hearts there? People keep going on about hearts this morning. I'll have to have a little look later because there's so much to talk about, dear. Oh, you've got a pear tree, have you? Oh, lovely. 100,000 hearts. Have I got 100,000 hearts? Oh, that's very kind of you, my darling. Periscope is buffering. We've got a little bit of a problem today, haven't we? If Periscope's buffering, is it buffering for everyone else? Then that must be something wrong here, perhaps with the stream going out today. I don't know. I don't know. Thank you for your hearts. Oh, hearts. Maybe it's because I've turned the... I don't know. We'll carry on. We'll carry on, my darlings, all right? Okie doke. Now... Have you got asthma? There's the question. Have you got asthma? I suffer from very mild asthma. It's not too bad at all. It's actually improved a lot since I did two things. Number one, I stop the cat coming into the main part of the house. Regular viewers will know this already, okay? She comes into the kitchen. She's got a little bed in the kitchen. She's nice and warm in there. Don't worry about that in the winter, okay? But there she stops. She can't come into the living room or any of the bedrooms. So I did that. Coming up, that must be about a year now. I did that ago. And also, I was looking around on the internet once about asthma and things. And one of the things that a few people said was, don't dry clothes in the house. Well, ever since I've been there, I've dried clothes in the house. I did have a tumble dryer. I got rid of that because I found I wasn't using it. Like I was too far too tight to turn the thing on, to be honest. So I got this tumble dryer. I can't have used it more than 15 times. Really, honestly. So I gave it away. I actually gave it away to my best mate, Ron. And I would hang the clothes over banisters, over radiators, that sort of thing. Now, little word of advice here. Do not hang clothes on radiators to dry out. Your radiators will rust. Maybe not straight away, but the damage is it's like a slow rot that sets in. I mean, I've got it myself. As you can see, over the years, I'm slowly rotting from the outside in. And possibly from the inside out as well. And at one point, these two lots of rots will just join together. The two rots will join together and I will literally fall apart live on this show. It will, you know it's going to happen at some point. I'll just be doing that and then suddenly, there'll just be a pile of dust on the floor. Like in some of the Star Treks and Doctor Who's. You know, when people are lasered? That's going to happen to me as the two rots meet. It's true. So do not dry clothes on radiators or on banisters in the house. So I stopped doing that. I've got a phone call coming in here. Let's take a phone call. Good morning. Who is on line 2317?
Good morning. You were talking about rotting DJs.
Good morning. I am a rotting
good
DJ.
Afternoon. Good afternoon.
That's Mr. Ray Reynolds, who we were just talking about earlier, isn't it? Good morning, Ray.
When you said rotting DJ, I thought, well, I must ring in now because it's my turn.
Well,
I'm also rotting.
Yeah, I mean, if I can just tell you, I was just talking about Red Ray's email a little bit later on. Ray used to do what I do with the DJing and singing and all that. Ray also plays the ukulele. Comes to all the karaoke nights. And Ray, on the rotting scale, is a little bit, I hate to say it, Ray, a little bit further along than me. When you see him, you know, I mean, you'd think he's got about 5 years left, to be honest.
Poor old thing. You know, I spoke to an even older DJ this morning, Norman Scott, who
Norman
some of
Scott.
Your viewers, listeners will know. He used to do bolts at Haringey and used to perform as a DJ with George Michael.
Yeah. Yeah.
In Haringey, all those years ago. But I was talking to Norman. Norman's 73, I think, and coming up to 74, and I am 68. So there you are.
But
you're a long way behind, dear.
You're almost dead,
but not quite.
That's what we all did. That's what I still do, and that's what we all used to do, isn't it? Oh, hang on. Perform. Just a moment. We got someone called Rusty who remembers you playing in the Queen's Arms in Hackney in the 1970s. Does that ring a bell?
Yes, yeah. Hackney
well, we've
Road.
Got we've got someone called Rusty. Rusty, would Ray know you? I wonder. Would Ray know you? We'll just wait for Rusty.
I'm trying to think who Rusty is.
To come back to us now. What's your real name, Rusty? And I'll maybe you might know him. But that's what it used to be. You know, DJs. We would perform.
Yeah.
I mean,
and
like
I
last
mentioned,
night.
The man responsible for my career was Tricky Dicky, Richard Skanes. Tricky Dicky, because he started the first gay discos in London, in Camberwell, in 1971. That's the year I met him.
Yeah.
And little did I know, through our meeting, I'd start DJing myself in Hackney Road.
Fantastic. Yeah. Rusty says, no, it was so busy in those days, you wouldn't remember. So, there we go.
Well, the pub was absolutely packed, yeah.
Was it?
Pubs on the... If you can imagine Hackney Road was like... We spoke about this recently. every street in Hackney, the main roads, had a pub on the corner.
Oh, yeah. And, well, wasn't that the disco, same? The whole country was like that, Ray.
Yeah, when disco came in, that was the beginning of, I suppose you could call it the beginning of the end, unfortunately, but for me it was a career. To play records in a pub was what the people wanted at that time, you know. Yes. It was too expensive to have live music anymore, and to get a DJ in, we'll probably play for a fiver a night. And that's how it really started in the East End, you know. Forgetting discotheques in the West End, but that's how the pub scene was in London. It was wonderful time. Right. You'd have loved it because you'd have fitted in straight away.
Well, Rusty is telling me you used to play a banjo sing-along at the end of the night. Is that right?
I did. How does she know that? Yeah, I used to play...
Yeah, it is a lady. Rusty is a lady, yes. Yeah.
Right. Well, yeah, she's absolutely right. I used to play Shep's Banjo Boys, yeah. And it was Swanee waiting for the...
Swanee!
Had nothing to do with disco at all, but it was just the theme that we used to play for a sort of a knees-up night thing. It was my introductory thing, yeah. And, it's strange how she remembers that. Yeah, that goes way back.
And there's someone says that it used to be like that in Melbourne, a pub on every corner. But actually, if you go to Australia, certainly in Sydney, no, I would say Australia has a lot more pubs than we do now. I mean, they're just closing down left, right and centre, aren't they, Ray?
It's a shame, isn't it?
I
remember watching a documentary about Australia pubs, and Spike Milligan was out there quite a lot. And there was a 6 o'clock rush. I think they used to close the bars. People used to rush from the offices at 5 o'clock, and you could have a drink between 5 and 6.
Yes.
And for some reason, the pub probably closed then, and they would get to the bar and wouldn't move. So they'd actually wouldn't move away from the bar and be served. And I can be a bit rude there. I think they used to wee on the floor because they didn't want to lose their spot. So can you
Kelly,
the six
Kelly
o'clock
Kim.
Round? You've got the front of the bar, got your drink. And obviously, big butch guys working on wherever.
Yeah, and, Kelly Kim is why a young spot, girl that watches. Kelly Kim's a young lady that watches the shows and comes along to the karaoke and what have you. And she's saying she wishes today was like then, because, of course, they don't know it. Anyone sort of under the age of, I don't know, 35... know it as we knew it, would they?
I must tell you something quickly about that Queen's Arms Hackney Road. When I started DJing there, October, November 1971, someone come up and said to me, oh, you know who was here last week, the residency you replaced? Lenny Peters. Well, Peters and Lee, they were on Opportunity Knocks in 1973. And their big record was Welcome Home.
Yes,
Big career. Lenny was blind, and Diane Peters worked with Jim Davis and later on in Pantomime. But Lenny Peters was a live musician in the pub, the Queen's Arms, where I performed my first disco experience.
Right.
And I was the replacement for a live entertainer who was Lenny Peters. There you are. And that tells you something about the scene in London.
You know, when they started moving to DJs, did you find a little bit of, from the live people, did you have any, like, animosity there? Did they hate you all?
I don't think so, because I think it was so gradual. No one knew it was coming. But certainly the kids, the youngsters, they loved... the idea of being able to have the records that they loved being blasted out on the in the pub. It was the amplification of it, I think.
Yeah,
don't forget, we'd all been brought up with record players and whatever. And I know there were stereos and hi-fi centres and all that, but when you went into a pub and it was really blasting out the hits of the day, you could imagine it.
If
you were unfortunate to live next door, you probably thought, "Oh, for Christ's sake, turn that down."
Well, is that how your neighbour feels now? Is it right?
No, I think we're all got a bit more. Well, certainly where I live, not Bracknell. I live in Woodford,
right?
And you can still get people who play their loud music. You can hear it over the garden sometimes. Think, oh bloody hell, here we go! But it's not like it was.
No, it's not.
70s and 80s, do you remember if you ever visited anyone in Hackney or whatever, in a tower block, and you thought, oh, Christ, how could you live with that? Because people used to boom out their music, didn't they?
Yeah.
But I tell you, it's a good thing. When the great big flat screen TVs came out, everyone wanted a flat screen TV, but they didn't worry about the amplification. Suddenly the volume went down a bit.
Yeah, that's right, because the speakers on the flat screen, well, see, that's where we've all been conned there, eh? Because because you buy the flat screen telly, and yeah, then you realise you've got to buy another bloody sound system to plug into the damn thing.
Exactly that, and that can't be how you should say that. Yeah, I bought a nice flat screen TV from Costco about 5 or 6 years ago. And the first thing I know, I just thought, oh, it's not as good as my amplification.
No.
My old Philips.
No. So then you had to go out and buy a blooming soundbar. I went into
what's the famous shop at the top of, opposite Good Street Station, PC World.
Yeah.
And there was this knockdown price on a Blu-ray then amplifier. And I thought, that's what I've got to have. And I never have it up full, but it's classy. You can have real sound.
Is it a valve? Is it a valve one?
Valves. Do you remember valves?
Is it a you can still buy valve amplifiers. And they're very expensive. Really expensive.
See, that goes back to the old days of disco. Yeah. When I first bought my first disco equipment, the amplifier underneath the deck did have a valve in. I think it probably had one valve in.
Right.
1971. I bought it second hand at the time. Yeah. But it did pump it out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, have you gone? I thought I'd lost you then for a minute. No, it's the way they now con us to buy bits and pieces that we used to get included. Right? Now, look at my car. Right, my car. A few weeks ago, I had a flat tyre. I opened up the boot.
I know that you're going to say. Yeah,
I opened up the boot. Where's the bloody spare tyre? There isn't. There's this little can of stuff that you squirt in.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, and then, you know, when I had it, went to have it repaired and all that, well, why did you get rid of the spare tyre?
No.
Well, it's to save space and height. You haven't saved any space because the space where the tyre was is still there. There's like a circle under there. I said, well, it's not very good. And then, you know, and then of course she says, well, you can buy one. I said, what do you mean I can buy one? You can buy a spare wheel. Do you want me to check the price?
Yeah, that's
so
right.
So we're now buying the stuff that we used to have thrown in for free.
I know, fools used to do that.
What
but we've moved
shocking.
On, you know. But when we were younger, I was saying to somebody the other day, we used to have to learn about cars because we were mainly driving second-hand cars.
Yeah.
And to get yourself about, you have to learn how to change the tyre, obviously. But we used to have to do other things. We used to change the fan belt. Do you remember
that?
Sometimes I changed the alternator. I don't know what it's called. The starter motor. Oh, the exhaust used to rot after 18
months. That's right, yes. That's right.
You used to have to lay underneath it.
That's right. Do you remember the exhaust bandage?
The exhaust bandages.
Did you have one of those?
Oh, that's right. I mean, you don't actually repair it properly. You just patch it up.
Put this bandage around it.
Oh, I can see what you mean. I haven't got a moving picture of you. I've got a still picture of you in a circle on your YouTube thing.
Have you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we've got some broadcast trouble today. It's kind of...
I've not been watching on Periscope.
We keep losing things. It'll come back in a minute.
I was going to tell you, have you got time for a technical thing?
Yeah.
When YouTube, I'm watching you on my screen, when your phone number comes up, part of the red phone number from Skype is obliterated with a YouTube logo
Has that disappeared again, honestly?
And I know somebody else has phoned in about that six weeks ago.
Why didn't anyone tell me that today then, honestly?
Well, I'm telling you now, but unfortunately, the picture that I had, I've now lost. So but I'm still listening to you perfectly, but I can't see you at the moment on the YouTube.
Right, hang on a minute. Let's just move that along. I think I can sort that out.
Mm.
Right. That
was the first... Actually, before we went into a bit of camp, that was the reason I thought I'd ring you and tell you that the...
was it?
The phone number was slightly obliterated by the YouTube
sometimes.
Logo.
I don't know why that happens sometimes. One minute. Let me just try and move it along.
The last four digits.
The last four digits. It should be all right now. Should be all right now.
Yeah.
When you get it back, it should be all right. Just refresh your screen and see if that comes back there on the YouTube.
Okay,
all right. Thanks, Ray. Lovely to talk to you.
We'll talk again. I'll see you on Monday, eh?
Okay. Cheerio now.
Cheers.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
There we are. Ray Reynolds calling in there. Oh, he's always got a good old story to tell us, our Ray. Now, here's the asthma story, okay? In India, then. India, as I say, when I stopped drying my clothes, stopped the cat, my asthma is vastly improved. It's barely a problem anymore, barely a problem. But in India, they have a different way of dealing with this altogether. Oh, yes. Forget inhalers. This is from this morning's Daily Mail. Asthma sufferers in India gulp down live fish to ease their symptoms in a 156-year ritual treatment. Oh, yes. A child gags and squirms as he is given treatment for asthma. But rather than a puff from an inhaler or a pill, the boy is forced to swallow a live fish. Oh, God, how awful is this? Every year, thousands of Indians line up to follow the slimy sea creatures, a traditional treatment for the condition. Asthma sufferers gather every June in the southern city of Hyderabad to gulp down the fish stuffed with a yellow herbal paste in the hope that it will help them breathe more easily. And there's all sorts of pictures here. I mean, it's frightening to see these pictures. It really is. I don't know how clear they are for you. administered by the Bathini Goud family, the therapy is a secret formula of herbs handed down by generations of family members. The clip shows the... You're not eating dinner at the moment, are you? The clip shows the wriggling fish being marinated in the paste before members of the Goud family appear to stick their fingers down people's throats to make sure the fish goes down. They often clamp their hands over their mouths afterwards to prevent gagging and give the neck a quick massage. Isn't this the worst thing you've ever heard in your life? Oh dear. The family will not reveal the secret formula of the yellow paste. Claim was received from a Hindu saint in 1845. Are you all getting cut off? Cut off and on all the time today? I get the feeling this is just not happening. We're not running very smooth. I wonder how long the fish lives, says Wendy. The herbs are inserted into the mouth of a live sardine or moral fish, and the wriggling fish are slipped into the patient's throat, often leaving them retching. I mean, the things are still alive. Oh, dear. The family maintains the fish, clear the throat on their way down, and permanently cure asthma and other respiratory problems if the treatment is administered 3 years running. I'm going to continue with the story, all right? After digesting the treatment, patients are told to go on a strict diet for 45 days. What, no ice cream? No crisps or chocolate? How awful. Thousands of people from India travel across the world. It's free. So they don't even charge for this. Patients are often forced to pry open the mouths of reluctant children who cry at the sight of the fish, while others pinch their noses, tip their heads back and close their eyes. In one clip, the girl is heavily scolded as she runs away. I would bloody well run away. Rights groups and doctors have complained that the treatment is unscientific, but the crowds also appear to disagree. Claims are rejected by the family. I don't know. I mean, I don't think I could do any of that. Could you swallow a live fish like that? How awful. I mean, give me a bar of Cadbury's Dairy Milk chocolate any day of the week, or Galaxy. One of the two. We've lost the YouTube. I thought that was going to happen. We have had connection problems today, so we're only on the Periscope now, which means I won't be able to show you anything, the video clip or anything like that. I don't think we can get that back now. Once that's cut off, it's gone, and that's it. So sorry about that. Hopefully you're still there. Well, on the Periscope. Thank you, Kelly Kim. How awful. It's just dreadful. Absolutely dreadful. You will be able to watch the complete recording of it in YouTube fashion, you know, with a widescreen and a pretty flashing lights and everything else, after we finish the show a little bit later on, okay? So we'll carry on. We're still on. See, there we are. So YouTube, we lost YouTube, but we're still here on Periscope. Thank the Lord for Periscope. Although we got cut off on there twice. Very strange what's going on today, but it's obviously an internet thing. So there we are. Let's have a look there. Now, what am I doing here? Let me have a look. Oh, yes. I wanted to read out something. Here, gang. One of our listeners, Nick, he's been with the show for quite a while. Nick and his mum as well. Nick Evans is. And I'll read you this, which has come from him, okay? I've been diagnosed 9 months ago with gastroesophageal reflux disease. My life has been on hold ever since, and I'm unable to work due to my hiatal hernia and non-functioning stomach sphincter muscle. I endure physical pain all day, every day from this disease. I've been in and out of hospital with the symptoms of this disease, which include nausea, tinnitus, pulsative tinnitus, burning head and neck, rotting enamel on teeth, heart attack mimic, asthma, burning lungs, coughing up blood, vomiting, passing out, esophageal spasms, vitamin deficiency, muscle spasms, IBS, dysphagia, and too much more to mention. The door to my stomach, basically, is open 24 hours, 7 days a week, and is leaking out stomach acid, pepsin, bile, and digestive enzymes. It eats away at my esophagus, and over time, this exposure has changed my cell line into Barrett's disease. If the reflux continues, it can progress to esophageal cancer, which has an 85% mortality death rate. Excuse me. I need surgery to fix the problem and stop the progression as instructed by medical professionals. Now, Nick is in the US of A. He's in America. Unfortunately, my healthcare insurance has denied my surgery. Most insurance companies approve it, including Medicare. I just have a bad insurance company that are basically leaving me to stay sick. I have a great surgeon that is willing to help me, but I need to pay for the procedure, which is $15,000. You would surely save me from the nightmare of the disease and from the failure of the health insurance circus we have to deal with in America. I hate to beg, but I have nowhere else to turn. I appreciate your help. If you can spare some dollars and share my story with your Facebook friends. So that's the story there, boys and girls. Okay? Now, Nick has a GoFundMe thing set up. Now, this is a thing where, if you want to, you can donate money. $1, $1,000, doesn't matter. Something, you know? So, if you're interested in perhaps reading this story, maybe reading it better than I probably read it out, to be honest, then you can do that. Now, I've posted it. It's a bit... I tried to find an easy way of telling you on the show what this... Oh, I can. Okay. www.gofundme.com/GERDpatient. I think that will work. Let me just try it for you. That works. Okay. All right. So once again, that site is gofundme.com/GERDpatient. GERDpatient. And that's where you'll find Nick's story there. And if you want to help him, he's been with the show for quite some years, as well as his mum. Name coming in my head now, Gene is well with us, all right, all those many years. Good. Wendy's having a look at that now. Anyone else, please feel free, if you want to send a little bit of money, then it'll show you what to do on there. Okay, boys and girls, finally on the show today, I wanted to talk about something. Hello, Kelly Kim. You're still there. Oh, wonderful, darling. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Something that I think in the back of our minds, we all know. I really do believe we all know this already. In the paper today is a story. The sixth. I need new teeth, don't I, really? The sixth mass extinction of the Earth has officially begun and could threaten humans' existence, scientists warn. The story says, Earth is entering a mass extinction that threatens humanity's existence, researchers have declared. A team of American scientists, this is in the Daily Mail, claim that their study shows without any significant doubt that we are entering the sixth mass great extinction on Earth. The study says that species are disappearing at a rate of 100 times faster than would normally be expected, and that is a conservative estimate. Such a catastrophic loss of animal species presents a real threat to human existence, the experts warn, as crucial ecosystem services such as crop pollination by insects and water purification in wetlands is also put at risk. Now, you've all heard the stories about the bees, haven't you? A lot of people, thank you, Kelly Kim, a lot of people are telling us now to do our gardens so that they attract bees. Indeed, I have done that, I've been doing that since September. Okay, I haven't done it specifically to attract bees, but what I've done will attract bees. I've got flowers everywhere. Kelly KMCC has a bee hotel. I've seen those. Are they little tubes, aren't they? Do they have a hive in them, Kelly Kim? How fascinating. And indeed, as I've been out in the garden quite a lot this week, I like to have my lunch in the garden, sometimes breakfast as well, certainly in this weather, because we don't get too much of this weather, do we, here in the UK? And I mean, it was a particular day last week, I was having breakfast, and the buzz from the bees sit behind me working because I've got a bush. Or they live in them temporary, do they, Kelly Kim? Okay, so you watch them going in and out, don't you? Behind where I sit to have my dinner, I've got a pyracantha bush that's like big spikes like that. But at the moment, it's covered in tiny little white flowers. It's lovely, it's beautiful. So I'm sitting there having dinner, literally a foot, 2 foot away from me, behind me, there are so many bees, and I could hear the buzzing going on behind me. They're not bothered by us. People are always afraid of bees. Don't be afraid of bees. You can go, while a bee is working on its flower, you can go right up to them, literally, like, if this is the microphone here, if that was a flower, you like that, and you can watch the bee working. I was watching one in a poppy last week, and it don't just go in a poppy, it's upside down, it's around the back of the thing, and then it flies off to the next one. And they were so noisy behind me, the buzzing. But it didn't worry me, because I've never seen a bee attack someone, you know, unless you annoy it. If you start going like that, then it feels threatened, doesn't it? Just let it buzz around you and off it goes. It's looking for pollen. It's all it's interested in is pollen. It's not interested in anything. It's not interested in you. Wasps, different thing altogether, Wendy, yes. They hate us and we hate them. They must be stamped on. That's it. Okay, bees, leave them alone. The story carries on. At the current rate of species lost, humans will lose many biodiverse benefits from three generations, within three generations, according to a professor. We are sawing off the limb that we are sitting on, this professor says. And the main things that are causing this are land clearing for farming, logging and settlement.
It's Ray.
Hello, Ray, yes.
You lost the signal.
Yeah, that's gone off altogether, Ray. We've lost the YouTube. Thanks for letting us know, mate. Yeah, that went off a while ago.
Johnny rang me as well. Yeah, okay, it's mate. I don't think it was my fault.
It's a connection thing today. Yeah, the whole recording will be on later, though, okay?
Oh, what a shame. Yeah, I was just enjoying it.
I know. But you will get the whole recording and be up at about 5 o'clock, I reckon,
okay? Yeah, mate, yeah.
All right, mate, cheers. Anyway, that was nice of him to call in and tell us that, wasn't it? So the main reasons: land clearing for farming, logging and settlement, introduction of invasive species. Now, this is a thing, and a particular example of this is in Australia, where they had a problem with some sort of native animal there. I can't remember what it was now. I can't remember. But to deal with this, they brought in the cane toad. Now, I'm not sure where it came from. They brought in these cane toads, massive things, which cured the problem they had, but then gave them a much bigger one. And there are so many of these blooming toads, and they are poisonous. So there's an example with invasive species, humans bringing something in to another environment where they're not supposed to be. But also, these invasive species are now coming to places on their own because the climate is changing. I suppose one day, here in the UK, we will get mosquitoes as this carries on. We've already got great big jellyfish and, Asian hornets. I was just about to mention those. We've got Asian hornets. These are massive things, vile things. Don't try and befriend those like the bees. And these other animals and insects are killing our own ones. Right? Global warming. Carbon emissions that drive climate change and ocean acidification. Cars on the road. Too many cars. Far too many cars. Every single one of them polluting, including the electric ones. Where do you think the bloody electricity comes from? It comes from a coal-fired or gas-fired power station most of the time. Just because you can't see the smoke coming out of there, don't think it's not coming out anywhere else. It's coming out of the power station, which you plugged in. So where you live, you think it's all nice and clean and green, yes, but the power station is still kicking out all this crap. Toxins that alter and poison ecosystems. The stuff that they spread all over crops and that to kill the insects. What do you think happens with it? It doesn't just disappear. It goes into the soil. Doesn't it? And so they are the main reasons there. And you can see it all around you. Walk through the streets of London and see the rubbish. And people don't care. They don't care. They're out on their Saturday night. They have half the kebab and throw the rest of it in the gutter in that little plastic box that is going to hang around for hundreds of years. That's just one plastic box. Have you ever seen the amount of rubbish that your town generates in 1 week? Where do you think it all goes? Recycling and all that. One of the biggest problems, I think, was the invention of plastic. We don't need it. Certainly not to put food in. We managed with that before. Stuff used to come wrapped in a bit of paper. Or glass bottles. The glass bottles were not recycled, as is recycled plastic, where everything has to be melted down. No, how easy was it to recycle a glass bottle? You just took it away, washed it out, and used it again. For years and years and years, that worked. Plastic has got to be the worst thing. There are pictures of various parts of oceans that are surrounded in plastic bottles. The thing is, people say eventually they break down to nothing. No, they don't. They break down. Takes a long, long time, but they break down. The thing is, they break down into small pieces of plastic, which fish eat. which you probably eat. There's the plastic. You know, I'm one of those factory farming people who can't bear to look at these factory farming, which turned me vegetarian years ago. Have you ever looked at factory farms? I know there's so many people around, you know, that they, oh, I don't want to know. They carry on stuffing their faces with these dead animals. I don't want to know. Do you actually know how this stuff is produced? All right, forget the welfare of the animal if you want to. I can't. Forget the welfare of the animal. But still, these chickens, they are running around in disgustingly filthy cages. They are pumped full of antibiotics. That's why the antibiotics are stopping to work, because we're giving them all to the animals so they can have higher profits. Awful. Just awful. Wendy's just posted a little video on my Facebook page, Facebook username chrisreardonuk. And I've seen that video. I know the video. You've got to watch that. Have a look at it. Wendy to Chris Reardon. Have a look at that video when we finish. We're going to finish shortly, Anna. You can see it all around you, though. Logging. Immense, vast areas. Vast, vast areas of forest being cut down. And it's so many examples. Even the Pope tweeted this week. And we, you know, you don't have to be religious. This new Pope is coming out with stuff that isn't always quite religious. And he said, let me see if I can find the tweet now. I retweet. How do I find a retweet? Following. Okay, so, because I hate that. I do follow the Pope. he came out, just forget the religious aspect of it, and I'll see if I can find that tweet that he sent this week. He's starting to tweet of things that are not religious, but just general common sense. Here's one here. An integral ecology includes taking time to reflect on our lifestyle and our ideals. Okay? Many things have to change course, but it is we human beings above all who need to change. We do. I'm just trying to find... Here we go. These are all tweets from the Pope. We know how unsustainable is the behaviour of those who constantly consume and destroy. A decrease in the pace of production and consumption can at times give rise to another form of progress and development. Reducing greenhouse gases requires honesty, courage and responsibility. All tweets he's sent out this week. Not a lot to do with religion, are they? This bloke has got common sense. Here's another one. What kind of world do we want to leave to our children who are now growing up? There was one particular one. I'm trying to find it now. Is it contrary? It is contrary to human dignity to cause animals to suffer or die needlessly. It's still not the one. I can't find it. I'm so sorry. I wanted to... Can you believe there's someone at the door now? Oh! Hang on a second. Stay there. This is mad, isn't it? This is mad. I'll stay there, mate. Dear me. What a show this has been today, isn't it? Nothing's working. I can't find this tweet. And he's done an awful lot of them, all on... here we go. I've forgot it. I've got it. This was really quite powerful. A tweet he sent a couple of days ago. Are you ready for this? And I want you to... So that's my best mate, Ron. He's just come downstairs. I said to him we would have dinner or something. Here it is. Here's the one, right? I want you to listen and think about this. The Earth, our home, is beginning to look like more and more an immense pile of filth. Read that again. The Earth, our home, is beginning to look more and more like an immense pile of filth. But here's my question for you. Will you drive your car any less this week? Will you use any less paper? Will you actively seek out in the supermarket items that are not covered in plastic packaging? Will you stop buying bottles of water? Maybe not, eh? So I don't see where we can go with this. I actually believe that we are doomed. There will be one or two people who try and do stuff, and what have I done? Well, I've done the bees and the plants, and I've got solar panels on the roof and things like that, but I still drive my car. How can I get to work otherwise? On the other hand, what is the point in going to work if in 100 years' time there are no humans left? Because we've poisoned everything. We've poisoned everything. There's too many of us. I actually think... this came into my head last night after I read this story. There is... a couple of things that could be done. I don't believe countries will agree to move over to renewable energy because there's too much money. It's all about money. I don't believe that. I don't believe agreements can be made on reducing carbon emissions. It's not reducing that we want to do. We need to stop it. We need to stop carbon emission. Not reduce. Stop. Stop. I'm just as guilty as everyone else. I'm sitting here with two computers on, lights, you know, loads of stuff. I'm sitting here with loads of stuff on. A mixer, you know, the meter's going round downstairs. I'm about to put the kettle on for a cup of tea. I'll turn the lawnmower on to... I'm just as guilty. Shouldn't be doing any of these things unless we had renewable, 100% renewable electricity. But it's not going to happen, is it? Because the money men want their money. They're not interested what's going to happen in 150 years' time. They're living for now. Living for now. There's two ways that this could be sorted. Are you ready for this? You won't like it. I think possibly the scientists could get together and unleash some sort of disease to get rid of a load of people. That would cure it. Wouldn't it? Think about it. Either that or some sort of... I don't think they'd use like a nuclear war or something like that, because you're still doing, you're doing more damage then. Some sort of disease. With too many people now, let's release this. And you wouldn't know about it. Or you could be getting into conspiracy theories here. Just an idea. You wouldn't know about it. How do you know that water you drank today is okay? How do you know? How do you know nothing's been put in your water? Are you going to boil the kettle now? Well, that doesn't get rid of chemicals. How do you know something isn't in the air that you breathe at this moment, slowly, surely, doing stuff to you? And certain people are able to avoid the areas where this stuff is, or have some sort of antidote. That would stop it, wouldn't it? Just a thought. Okay? So I actually, I mean, it was actually Larry Hagman, you know, JR from Dallas. He was interviewed once because he got all these solar panels. And the interviewer said to him, he said, do you think, you know, we will be able to avoid the catastrophe that can happen? And Larry Hagman said, no. He said, I think it's too late. He said, but we can have a lot of fun trying. And I really think that's the case. I don't think we can stop it, because people can never bloody well agree. I mean, have you ever been into a committee? Have you ever been a member of a committee or ever seen a committee meeting? They sit there rowing away in these little church halls and things like that. Well, if they can't agree, what do you think a room of prime ministers and presidents are like? Oh, Big Dave is in there, and Mr. Obama and old Merkel. You can see them sitting there rowing away, agreeing on all the climate change things, and then coming home on a private jet. Oh, yeah, very good. It's not going to happen. I don't think we can avoid it now. I really don't. I don't think we could have avoided it 10 years ago. However, people watching this show will all be safe, because I shall just put you all in a big plastic bubble and we'll all be happy. All right? Thank you very much today, boys and girls. That's it for the show today. I suppose you want the bit of music at the end, do you? Do you want, even though we've lost the YouTube, do you want a bit of music at the end, do you? Thank you very much for watching and listening, boys and girls. Don't forget, I've got an email address if you ever want to send us an email at any point. My email address is chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. Join me for my Periscope videos. Download the app Periscope and look for username chrisreardonuk. I'm also on Twitter and YouTube and Facebook. Username the same on all of those, chrisreardonuk. Have a lovely Saturday. See you soon, all right? Bye-bye now. 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 See you soon, all right?